Anyway, today we are going to be back in 1 Corinthians. It's going to be in chapter 9. Paul delved into what becomes a difficult topic for us because we bring our humanity into it. It's really not all that difficult, but this conflict between religious liberty and legalism. This is the battle of the ages. You know, our human brains are so logical. We want equations. We want this equals this. We want, if I do this, this will happen, or if I do this, this will happen. We want to define everything and then judge people based on whether they are following the equation or not. And religious liberty, once we have the grace of Jesus, that kind of blows all that out of the water. That's the difference between what Jesus brought and what the Pharisees had to offer. And it's such a stark contrast, this grace as opposed to earning favor from God. And yet, as much as a relief as Jesus was and is and the message that he brought, still, humans, man, we just keep drifting back into, okay, well, yeah, Jesus, but I need a list. I need to know if I can do this. Can I do this? Am I not supposed to do this? And Paul addressed that. You know, we got into it last week in this thing of spiritual liberty versus legalism. I heard this great teaching from J. Vernon McGee this week. I just love J. Vernon. If you've never listened to him, man, this is a guy from, I don't even know, 50s, 60s, maybe early 70s. Has a radio ministry. He's been gone for years, but he has a radio ministry that has thrived. And it goes all around the world, even today. And it works because he just teaches through the Bible, which is what we love around here. But he's just kind of a homespun kind of guy. I don't know if he's from Nashville, but I know he did pastor a big church in Nashville at one point before he ended up in L.A. and kind of became world-renowned. But he's got those Southernisms. He has a great way of explaining some things sometimes. And in teaching about this religious liberty thing this week, I heard him say, he said, you have the liberty to swing your fist anywhere, anytime you want. But your religious liberty ends at the beginning of my nose. I thought, man, what a great way to say what Paul was saying in chapter 8 last week. Yes, you can do pretty much anything you want, but when it starts affecting somebody else, if you're truly a follower of Christ, you choose to stop doing that. At the beginning of my notes. I love that. All things are allowed for us, but our love for others should prohibit us from doing anything that would be harmful to somebody else. Today we're going to hear Paul testify to the fact that he is willing to give up blessings due him simply because they might be a stumbling block to others who are less mature in the faith than he is. So let's pick this up today. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1. Am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? Now these are rhetorical questions. They don't require an answer. Of course, all of these are true statements. He's just setting up the bigger point that's coming. Picking it up in verse 2. If I am not an apostle to others, yet doubtless I am to you. For you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. My defense to those who examine me is this. Do we have no right to eat and drink? Do we have no right to take along a believing wife as do the other apostles, the brothers of the Lord and Cephas? Or is it only Barnabas and I who have no right to refrain from working? Whoever goes to war at his own expense, who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its fruit, or who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk of the flock? Do I say these things as a mere man, or does not the law say the same also? For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Is it oxen God is concerned about? Or does he say it altogether for our sakes? For our sakes, no doubt, this is written, that he who plows should plow in hope, and he who threshes in hope should be partaker of his hope. Apparently, his very apostleship has been challenged by some here, and so he brings that up. Also, it would seem that there's kind of a murmuring going on. You know, maybe nobody has come to him specifically and said the things that he's covering here, but there's definitely an undercurrent here going on. Some people grumbling about Paul as though he were somehow taking advantage of his position, as though somehow he's seeking worldly gain for his ministry. If there's anybody in the Bible who doesn't receive worldly gain for their ministry, man, it's Paul. I mean, this guy was stoned for his ministry. But this is happening because that's how the enemy works. You find an effective teacher, you find an effective pastor, an effective evangelist, and what are you going to see? The enemy's coming along right behind him with guys planting seeds of doubt. Yeah, what he said is true, but did you hear about this? But I wonder what he meant when he said seeds, little seeds of doubt. And our overactive minds and imagination, somehow things get blown up into something even though they are nothing. This is obviously what's happening here. He points out that some are putting him on a different tier of importance than some of the other apostles, like James and Peter and those guys. It's like those are the apostles and he is an apostle. As though that means there are different ways that he should be related to. Doesn't make any sense, but that's how humans work. They act as though the other guys are more important than he is, as though they shouldn't be bothered by having to have a job to support themselves. But Paul, I mean, he's just a second-tier guy. Paul and Barnabas, I mean, they're doing ministry. They're doing good work. Yeah, they started this church. Yeah, he's our spiritual father, but we don't need him preaching all day long. He could go get a job and take care of himself. Maybe some of the grumbling is coming from within the fellowship. Who made you king? You're not the boss of me. He's already expressed how he considers himself to be their spiritual father. He relates to them in that way. And I think now we see they relate back to him in the exact same way. We got a bunch of teenage baby believers here. You're not the boss of me. Go away. Leave me alone. I got saved. Let me now just do what I want to do. But Paul loves him. He can't do that. Maybe some of the grumbling is coming from outside the fellowship. These are the guys that follow along behind him. Maybe that guy told you what? Who gave him authority to lecture anyway? He's not one of those who walked with Jesus before the cross. That's what people were saying about him. He was constantly hounded by others who were supposedly believers. They would come into town after he left. He would come in, have this amazing evangelism event and time, and people would come to the Lord and a church would get planted, and he would go on to the next town. Paul was a barnstormer. I mean, he's a pastor too. That's where the letters come in. But in his heart, he's a barnstormer, man. He wants to go town to town to town and just share the gospel and get everybody in the world saved. And so he would do that, and he would pour his heart out in evangelism, and people would get saved, and then he would leave, and then these other guys would come in and just nitpick every single thing that he said, trying to refute the simple gospel that he taught. There was this group called the Judaizers, and they would come in, and they had been Jews, and now they ostensibly are saved, and yet grace eludes them. They just can't get this concept. They were so indoctrinated in the sacrificial system and all of that, and that's how you please God. And so they came in after getting saved going, okay, now we have Jesus. That's great. Now we don't have to worry about eternity, but surely we're still supposed to do all of the stuff too. And so they would come in after Paul comes in teaching grace, and they would try to drag people back into the list of stuff to do, putting that burden on them that nobody could keep in the first place. It's just a brilliant attack of the enemy. Often these were legalists who hated the fact that Paul taught so much on spiritual liberty, that the very thing he's addressing in this letter, I think they were jealous that he was so freed up. And they just weren't there. So instead of trying to get where he was, they tried to pull him back down. And everybody else along with them. This word apostle in the Greek, it just means a messenger, one sent on a mission. That's what the word apostle means. Back then, to be acknowledged as an apostle of Jesus, meaning you are a messenger of Jesus, sent by Jesus to share the gospel, called by him and sent by him, you had to have seen the risen Lord, and miracles had to have been worked through you in your service to the Lord. That's kind of the criteria. Because all of a sudden, you know how this works in humanity. All of a sudden, there were all these guys that popped up going, we're apostles of Jesus. Listen to what we say. And they were just in it for the money or the fame or whatever, just the attention sometimes. So to differentiate between all those guys and the real deal, that this is kind of the litmus test. Okay, did you see the risen Lord? And are there any supernatural things that have happened through you that can't be explained any other way than that God did something? Paul certainly passes this test, just like Peter, just like James, just like John, just like those guys. His testimony is that he was confronted and called literally by Jesus on that road to Damascus, and that later on he went away for a time where he was taught by Jesus himself. There's no hierarchy of apostles of Jesus in the New Testament. Also, there are too many miracles to mention. Happen all the time. Amazing things happen through Paul's ministry. Both things in protection to him and people getting healed through his proximity to where they were. That was something he always had to be on the lookout for because he didn't want to be worshipped. And there were so many supernatural things happening around him that people were drawn to him. And he had to point them back to Jesus. His point here is this: I am an apostle of Jesus, sent by him personally to share the gospel and to teach believers about discipleship. Would it really be improper for me to receive compensation from you for this? Really? By the way, he says, here are some common sense logical reasons that support the idea of my receiving such sustenance from you. One, people that work the land, do they not receive part of the crops from the land? Yeah, when an ox is set up in a press, and if you're not familiar with this, you got a big circle, you got a thing in the center with the thing that ties itself to the ox, and they throw all the stuff on the ground, and the ox just walks around and breaks the husks off of the harvest there. That's how they separated the chaff away. And Scripture specifically said back in the law, don't muzzle an ox. You've got him there doing work. He's doing something for your benefit. It's not like he's doing that for himself. Don't muzzle him. Let him eat. If you have to give up part of that crop for him to keep working, you might want to do that. Unless you want to get in there and walk around in circles yourself. That's what Paul brings up here. You let the ox eat because he's earned it, for one thing, and because he needs it to continue working. He said, Why is an apostle any different? Why is a minister of the gospel any different than that? Verse 11. If we have sown spiritual things for you, is it a great thing if we reap your material things? If others are partakers of this right over you, are we not even more? Nevertheless, we have not used this right, but endure all things, lest we hinder the gospel of Christ. Do you not know that those who minister the holy things eat of the things of the temple, and those who serve at the altar partake of the offerings of the altar? Even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel. But I have used none of these things, nor have I written these things that it should be done so to me. For it would be better for me to die than that anyone should make my boasting void. For if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of. For necessity is laid upon me. Yes, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. For I do this willingly. I have a reward. But if against my will, I have been entrusted with a stewardship. What is my reward then? That when I preach the gospel, I may present the gospel of Christ without charge, that I may not abuse my authority in the gospel. Paul says, some of you guys are accusing me of ministering for money? He's like, hey, I've got all these logical arguments that explain why it would be perfectly normal to receive some compensation for this. I'm being used by God to bless you. And if I could just focus on that, then all the more I could bless you. But, he says, beyond that, I don't do this for money. I do this because the gospel is in my bones, and it just I'm on fire for Jesus, and I have to share with everybody. How could you accuse me of such a thing? You spent time with me. You know me better than that. He said, but, again, logically, a lot of you came out of Judaism. Do you not realize the correlation here? The priests that ministered to you in the temple, where did they get a lot of their food? From the sacrificial offerings. Did they steal that? No, that was the way it was lined up. That's the way God ordered things. For them to receive sustenance from the offering, for them to have a place to live, for them to have land that God provided for them so they wouldn't have to worry about those things so that they could devote themselves to your ministry. He keeps hammering this home. I think these people have gotten way off track because he's just going on and on and on. He says, but there's an even bigger reason here. Verse 14, even so, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live from the gospel. Hey, here's all my logical reasons. Here's how we've seen it done in the past that you guys are familiar with. It makes perfect sense. I can go all the way back to Leviticus and show you how this was God's plan. But Jesus said. Jesus said. That's the end of the argument right there. He says, oh, and by the way, what about this? You do support some of the other people that come in here and minister to you. I think Paul is dumbfounded at this point. What? And parents, you know what I'm talking about. And these kids are treating their spiritual father like he's the only idiot in the world. Everybody else makes perfect sense, and he's the idiot. And yet he's the one that has provided for them from the get-go. He's the one that loves them, that keeps coming back, that is writing letters and answering questions. He's ministering to them. And yet they have these other guys who are coming in a little bit at a time, in, we're out, and they're in, and they're out. And they're giving them funds to support that ministry. But when it comes to Paul, there's all this murmuring. Crazy. Paul's laid out the case for why it would be perfectly right and fitting for the group of believers to gather up funds or food or clothes or whatever and provide for his physical needs so that he could devote all of his time to teaching and witnessing. By this logic, since other churches did sometimes help out with Paul's material needs, human nature would say, just let these guys go, Paul. Let them go. They're not getting it. They're not growing. They're not maturing in their faith like these other guys you're ministering to. These other guys that are reciprocating your love and supporting you back. Why don't you just go spend more time with them? That's not Paul. He's not led by human nature anymore. He's different. I'm sure the thought entered his mind from time to time because that's how the enemy works. I'm sure the enemy tried to plant seeds of doubt in Paul's mind. Maybe those people aren't even saved because they just don't get it. Maybe I should focus my time somewhere else. But, verse 12, if others are partakers of this right over you, are we not even more? Nevertheless, we have not used this right, but endure all things, lest we hinder the gospel of Christ. Verse 15, but I have used none of these things, nor have I written these things, that it should be done so to me. For it would be better for me to die than that anyone should make my boasting void. What Paul cares about is the gospel and spiritual maturity. Does he accept money or whatever help that he got from some of the other churches that he planted? Yes. No reason not to. He's laid out the logical argument why that's perfectly fine. Perfectly good and right and normal for him to receive wages for his work on other people's behalf. But because there are some who would try to twist that into a bad thing and therefore lead some of these folks astray or trip them up, he says, I'd rather just keep making tents and buying my own food. It makes logical sense. It is a command from the Lord for me to receive my sustenance from this work. But if that's a stumbling block for you, hey, I'll find my food somewhere. God will provide for me. I'm okay. I don't need that. Because that's what mattered to him. He said, you know what, that's harder for me. That's hard work. But if it's better for you, you mean that much to me. And I would rather not bother you with it. Paul doesn't want to be lumped in with those who seem to be driven by the money, because there are plenty of them out there. There are plenty of them around today. You see them. A lot of these TV guys, man, they're all about, send us money, plant seeds of faith. I heard a pastor this week say, one of those guys makes a couple $1 million a year. I don't see him investing in my ministry. I don't see him planting seeds of faith in our house. There's a guy on the radio I used to listen to. He has all these comic characters, and one of them was called the Reverend Deuteronomy Skaggs. And he was just the epitome of a ridiculous TV evangelist. You know, he was trying to raise money because he wanted to start a home for wayward showgirls. You know, it was just that kind of deal. And his tagline was always, "Help me, help you, help me." He would come on and say, "Don't you think the Lord deserves a fine house?" Yes, he does. "Don't you think the Lord deserves a circle driveway?" Yes, he does. "Don't you think the Lord deserves a Porsche?" Yes, he does. And he's asked me to drive it. See, those guys existed then, they exist now, they will exist until the end of time here. And Paul does not want to be lumped in with those guys. He's saying, there is no merit to your argument, but if that's the way you're going to see me, if I take money from you, please keep your money. I don't want that. Because what matters to me is you getting as close to Jesus as you can get. As for supporting those in ministry, here's what I would say. Today, we have organized ourselves into church fellowships. We've added a layer of bureaucracy here. The churches are entities in their own right. And so now, instead of really directly supporting me or any other pastors, what happens is you give to the entity. And the entity writes checks to me and the rest of the staff and to the landlord and to the utility companies, and everything gets done. Other ministries with support and all that. But don't forget, See, that can kind of isolate you from the process a little bit. Don't forget that Calvary Chapel Murfreesboro is you. It's only an entity insofar as there are participating members. The checks will continue to be written only so long as you continue to give. That's the way it works. We actually have an official order for dropping things off of the budget if we were to run on financial hard times of some sort. That had to happen years ago when the economy tanked, because you know you can have 70 faithful tithers, but 10% of their income this year might not be the same amount of money as 10% of their income next year. So this church has gone through that kind of, hey, having to get more lean and trim and having to cut expenses and all of that. But we have a plan. If things get bad around here and folks aren't giving, and God doesn't provide it some other way, then there's a list. And the money that I get for my housing allowance is on top of that list. That's the first thing that stops. And then that goes on to the rest of the staff. And then it goes on to the outside ministries. And then it ends up with the building. So worst case scenario, we all end up hanging out in the field somewhere. But we'd still be getting together and studying the Bible. I'm very appreciative of very appreciative of the job God has given me that raises funds, and I'm very appreciative of the money that I do receive from here. That's not the reason that I'm here. And if that were some stumbling block in some way, I'd say, well, we'll just stop doing that, because that's not what matters. And that's what Paul is saying here. And you guys have always been faithful in your giving, so we haven't had to deal with that on any serious level as yet. But I just want to encourage you to remember that your decision as to whether you do or don't give this week or the next, that affects the entity. But we're not stockpiling huge amounts of money here. I firmly believe that you should be giving financially to the ministry that is feeding you. And if you can't trust the ministry that is feeding you with your money, you should probably find another ministry to go to. That's certainly one application for us in this passage. Paul just laid out the logic. Hey, ministry costs money. The lives of the ministers cost money, and they have to get that from somewhere. It makes perfect sense if the congregation provides that. His logical arguments there still hold water. But here's the larger matter to be dealt with here, and it reflects back to chapter 8. To actually show love to God and everybody else, there will be certain times when the right thing for all of us to do is to let something go. Forgo something. Give something up specifically for the benefit of others. I'm talking about something that is your right, something that others should be giving you, that they should be doing for you, that is just right. Sometimes we got to look at that and go, oh well. Don't drop that. Because it's not the most important thing. Things that would be good and right and normal for us to expect and to be able to have and enjoy, and yet if they're a hindrance or a stumbling block for somehow for somebody else, let go. I was serving in a ministry one time, and I had a bunch of equipment for sale, and the ministry just happened to be at a point where they needed that kind of equipment. So I go to the pastor. I say, hey, I've got this stuff. I am going to sell this stuff. I have to sell the stuff. I can't give it away. I'm going to put it on Craigslist, but if this would be a benefit to the church, here's what the stuff costs. You let me know if the church would like to buy that stuff. And if so, great. Take it. If not, that's okay. I'll put it on Craigslist. I mean, we're fine here. I'm not asking for any favors. If it's good for you, it's good for me. The decision was made. The equipment was bought. It changed hands. It included one large piece of equipment. And a while later, I mean a month later, the guy comes to me and there had been some grumbling amongst others in the fellowship. You know, I've had some guys looking at catalogs and they think that we could have bought this kind of equipment cheaper than what we got it from you. It looks like you took advantage of the church. And the only thing that hadn't been done was the payment for that one big piece of equipment yet. And so I looked at him and I said, take that. Will that make it right? Because I didn't want him to have to deal with the grumbling. That was more important to me than to have that cash. I knew God would take care of the cash side. Yeah, that's a real world thing. That kind of stuff happens, and happens way too much in churches. Finger pointing and the murmuring and the mumbling, and the enemy finds a place to dig in, and he just plants a little seed that, hey, there's something not quite right here. And then people get to talk and it becomes something. And that was nothing. It was not a valid argument. And I would have been right in standing my ground. That wasn't what mattered more to me. This is the lesson Paul is not only teaching here, but he also living out by example. And because he loves these baby believers so much, you know what? He's glad to do it. He trusts God for his sustenance. He's not worried about that. He's latched onto this fact that he has received so much grace from Jesus. He doesn't mind extending that to others. He knows that he's so unworthy for salvation in and of itself that what else is he going to hang on to tightly after that? He's looking at Jesus going, man, I was on my way. I had the letters in my hand to allow me to persecute believers when you saved me. When you stepped into the picture and got my attention and saved me. So am I going to make sure everybody else is fair and square with me? Is that going to be my goal, my priority? No. Let that stuff go. Maybe you'll do the same thing for them that you did for me. This is the big picture others should see in us once we have become a new creation in Christ. If we have become a new creation in Christ, they should see somebody who worships God and somebody who's taken the focus off of themselves and is devoted to being a blessing to others. That's what we have to do if we claim we're following Jesus. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Paul says back in chapter 8, here in Corinthians, chapter 8, verse 9, but beware lest somehow this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to those who are weak. And then down in verse 13, therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never again eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble. It's about taking that focus off of me and what I want and what is right for me to have, and instead letting my day be governed by, what can I do for you? Whoever you are that happen to be standing in front of me, how can I make your day better? And if it costs me something, all the better, really. Verse 19, for though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all that I might win the more. There it is. That's discipleship. That's worship. That's loving God and loving everybody else. That's having your priorities in line. That's taking up your cross and following Jesus right there in that verse. Paul has decided to run every thought, every action, every attitude, and every word through that filter. Does this help bring myself or somebody else closer to Jesus? That's definitely a lesson for us today. Something for us to look at honestly, and we might need to make some adjustments there. I know I do. It's hard to keep that focus. It's something you have to train in yourself. It has to become a habit. And you have to actively work against the old habits, which are mine. Have any of you parents ever had to teach your baby the word mine? They just figure that out somehow. Mine. Grab. Turn. Mine. Isn't it amazing? We don't have to teach them how to lie. We don't have to teach them how to steal. We don't have to teach them to be self-centered. That is human nature. And if we're going to be this new creation, we got to let God establish new patterns in our life. And it's not always going to be easy. It's not always going to be really, really hard. Back to verse 19. For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all that I might win the more. And to the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law. Not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. To the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. You see how singular in purpose Paul really is? This is beautiful. He enjoys the freedom from the law that he's found in Christ, but he's taking the liberty that he has, and he's taking the ability he now has to enjoy all things, and he's taking the opportunity he now has to make his own decisions, and he's choosing to serve others. He's choosing to put himself second behind everybody else that he runs into. It's a powerful testimony. He's taken Jesus' words seriously. Go back to John chapter 13. You remember the scene, the Last Supper, and Jesus kneels down and washes the feet of the disciples there. John chapter 13, verse 12. So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Jesus said, "I came to serve. You want to follow me? You're going to serve. You're not going to seek your own first. Sometimes you're not going to have time to seek your own at all." Singular in purpose. Clear, Christ-centered motivation for everything he does. That's Paul. What is that singular purpose? The possible salvation of the lost, and making sure his influence moves believers closer to Jesus. That's his first consideration in all things. Everything else must fit into that goal, into that parameter, or he just drops it, pushes it away. See, that's what we kind of get backwards in the American church, because we're so self-centered as a culture. Too often we get this part of our new life backwards. We try to add Jesus to everything else we're already doing. And we try to squeeze him in and make him fit into the mix. When what we're supposed to do is see if other stuff will fit into this new life we have with Jesus. And if it doesn't, we just got to let it go. We've got got to make sure that that is our new focus, that that's what we really want, loving God and loving everybody else. And everything that doesn't fit into that, that doesn't help that, is a weight, it's a shackle, it's something that's slowing us down. It's got to go. Verse 24. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. He's describing brilliantly here that somebody who is what we call all in. All in. The definition of what that phrase means, it varies greatly around the world depending on what culture the Christians are living in, but it shouldn't. There's really only one definition for all in when it comes to Jesus. It doesn't really matter where you live or what your circumstances are or what the culture thinks. In some places now it means all in means you're willing to meet secretly with other believers so you can worship and learn about Jesus, even though if you're caught, it will certainly mean harsh penalties or harassment. In some places in the world right now, all in means being willing to be put to death rather than renounce your faith in Jesus, because nothing is going to come between you and your God. There are Christians right now having to make that choice. Today, there are Christians having to make that choice. And then here sits America. And here we are. What does all in mean here? All in America for a Christian so often means I'm willing to give up a couple of hours most Sundays to come hang out with some other believers. And I'll share Jesus every time I can find a Facebook post that's themed Jesus. I'll share it. I'll be steadfast in doing that. And I'll mention Jesus occasionally in conversations, if it won't be offensive to anybody. If it's convenient. And especially if it'll make me look spiritual. I wonder if when looking at America today, if Jesus doesn't feel the same way he did toward Jerusalem right before he was about to go to the cross. Remember what he said? Matthew 23:37, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." I don't want to beat you guys up. I honestly feel like this congregation does a better job than most with this. I really do. But are we a fellowship of believers who are consumed with doing whatever it takes to make sure that others know the truth about Jesus? Or are we singular in purpose like Paul? Are we running the race, or are we watching others run the race from the sidelines and clapping? Get out there. I made this point before. The hands and feet, that's who we're supposed to be. The hands and feet of Jesus were dirty because he was doing stuff. He was helping people. He was seeking their blessing, not his own. Scripture uses this race metaphor a lot. Why? It speaks of motion in a specific direction toward a specific goal, which is what our life with Christ should look like. And this is all throughout the Bible, but all the way back in Isaiah chapter 40, "But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." And Paul uses it all the time. He must have been an athlete, or at least a guy that loves sports. In Philippians chapter 3, he says, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." In Hebrews, which I happen to think Paul wrote, we don't know for sure, he says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Paul says, he puts it this way, he says, even though this isn't the case, run as though you have to get to the goal first to be awarded your prize. Now, that's not the case. But if that's your attitude, you're going to be temperate in all things. You're not going to let anything hinder you from running as fast as you can. You're not going to be consumed by what everybody else is doing right or doing wrong. You're running toward Jesus, and you're trying to drag people along with you. You're not rooting against any of the other runners. You're just making sure you are focused on the goal. That's what we have to do. Stay with me. A great example of that right now. American Ninja Warrior. I love that show. It's fantastic. Just normal people consumed by a goal, and they wrap their life around this goal. Now, I wish they would choose a different goal. I wish they would choose Jesus, but it's such a great metaphor. They are consumed with nothing more than getting from here to there and beating every obstacle that's along the way. And so these are extremely competitive people. They're almost all are really serious about it. They train and they run to win, but they also support one another. They're very competitive, but against the obstacles, not against each other. And you watch these guys, and they cheer louder than anybody for the other guy who's doing well. And they cry for the ones that get their heart broken on that obstacle course. They understand. There's a lot of empathy for one another. It's almost like they're on a team, and if any one of them beats the course, they kind of feel like they all had a part in that. And that's beautiful. They're united against the common obstacle, and they're reaching for a common goal. And they're laying aside everything that would slow them down, that would weigh them down, that would keep them from getting there. There's a real sense of camaraderie and support and help, and they cheer one another on. This year, I've been watching this for a few years now, nobody ever makes it to the end. When you get to the final stage of this thing, which is in Vegas, there's you know, a couple of stages you have to get through to get to the final thing, and nobody has ever made it to the stage right before the final thing. That's how tough this competition is. They've been doing it for, I don't know, maybe 10 years. Nobody has ever made it even to begin the next to last stage. It's that tough. And so this year, you know what happened? Two guys made it. Not just to the next to the last one. Two guys made it to the last one. It's amazing. It's blowing people's minds. One of them is a newcomer. Nobody knows him. They call him Popeye because literally his forearms are like this. He's the only human I've ever seen that literally looks like Popeye. It's crazy. And he's just a normal guy. You know what? He's a camera guy. For sporting events. Just a guy. Dad with kids. Everybody loves Popeye. Man, he's the story, right? And then there's this other guy that's real popular too. He's a world-class rock climber. He works as a busboy because he doesn't want anything to get in the way of his rock climbing. Because he doesn't care about money. But he's world-renowned in rock climbing. Both of those guys make it to the last thing. And the last thing is a 50-foot climb up a rope in 30 seconds is what you have to do to get to the top. Winner gets $1 million. All you got to do is make it to the top and push the button. Popeye did it. He made it. He had less than like a half a second left on the clock. And he made it. Nobody's ever even gotten to it. He's the first one to ever try it, and he made it. And everybody goes nuts, man. The crowd goes nuts. The rest of the athletes go nuts, and they're clapping and crying and screaming. And he's just overwrought with emotion, man. And then the next guy comes up. He made it too. Nobody's ever even attempted it. Both these guys made it, and he made it like 3 seconds faster. So immediately, Popeye goes from the first guy in the world to ever make it all the way through this thing, and he just won $1 million. And now, 2 minutes later, he's one of two guys to have made it all the way to the top, and the other guy got $1 million. I would have been so distraught. Can I just be honest with you? He was so happy for the other guy. They let the family up there to hug on the guy and his kind of teammates that he trains with, and they're all up there, and then here comes Popeye, man. He's right in the middle of it, and he's hugging the guy and telling him that he loves him and he's happy for him. That is what our race is supposed to look like. Always heard that Christians are the only army that shoots their own wounded. Sometimes we have a horrible attitude with our brothers and sisters. Just because we're having a better day today than they're having. We're all over them, man. What's wrong with you? It's supposed to be like this. So that's the main point of the race metaphor. Here's the other one. A few of the runners at American Ninja Warrior, they're not serious at all. They're really not. And they don't even pretend to be serious. Okay? They didn't train. They didn't prepare. They showed up. They wanted to get on TV. They wanted the T-shirt. They wanted to be in the group picture with all the other guys that were competing. They wanted to be known as part of that. But they didn't want to sacrifice anything to accomplish anything. They didn't want to give up any of what they already had to get over there. They would rather carry their stuff and only make it a quarter of the way there than drop their stuff and make it to the end. They don't train, they don't sacrifice, they don't do battle, they aren't invested in the race. They're in the group picture, but they don't have the camaraderie, they don't actually accomplish anything. That's how it is in the body of Christ. If all those in America who claim to be Christians show up only for the group pictures in the churches across the nation, if they only want to be associated with the believers, if they're not actually running the race or reaching for the goal or following Jesus, when you do the polls, the numbers are still staggering. If you could go by poll numbers, this is an overwhelmingly Christ-like nation because we got a whole bunch of people following Jesus, supposedly. It ain't so. It ain't so. There are hangers-on in the church who are really attracted to religion. There's nothing wrong with that, but they're just attracted to religion. To the group meeting, to the fellowship, to the label. But they're not training. They're not running. They're not working. They're not invested. And so if that happens to be you today, listen, I've been that guy. If that happens to be you today, please consider your way. Because here's where I want us to end up. As Paul was nearing the end of his time on earth, he's writing to Timothy. He was able to look back over his life since Jesus saved him and called him and equipped him and used him. And he was able to say this in 2 Timothy chapter 4. He says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Oh, to be able to lay on our deathbed and think back over our life and have that thought. What peace that must have brought. as opposed to looking back over all the missed opportunities and the wasted time and how many episodes of that sitcom did I memorize, and yet I can't answer many questions about the Bible at all? How well do I know the plot lines of that drama, and yet I can't explain the gospel to you? How many details do I know about Caitlyn Jenner? And yet I can't really tell you much about Paul or Peter or maybe even Jesus. I don't want any of us to end up in that situation of regret, knowing that we spent so much time focused on things that do not matter. They only matter as a source of entertainment or a brief time of comfort or something that we can enjoy while we're recuperating from hard work. But what if we're not doing the hard work? What are we recuperating from? May this be a fellowship that charges forward. Singular in focus is everything that I'm doing today, all of my thoughts. And I'm talking about the real deal. I'm talking about our hearts. Is this who we want to be? I don't mean make your list and check everything off. You might as well just goof off. I mean, sit down in our hearts today to cry out to God and say, help me to be so focused on you that nothing slows me down, that nothing hinders me today. Help me to drop everything that is a hindrance, that is a stumbling block for me or anybody else. Use me today. Draw me closer to you and use me to bring others along so that we can all feel like Paul at the end and be comfortable with who we have been, who we've chosen to be. May we take that spiritual liberty that grace gives us and use it to choose to be a servant to others. What does that mean in your life? I don't know. I'm not talking about church programs. I'm talking about you individually today looking at God and saying, will you help me to focus on you today and what you want me to do so that I can make a difference, so that I can move forward, so I can run the race that's set before me? Is it a plan? Father, thank you. Thank you for this amazing transformation we see in Paul. He was a man who was prone to addictive behavior. He was addicted to the law. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees, a man among men, a leader of leaders. He sat at the feet of the most intense teachers that Israel had to offer, and he surpassed their knowledge. He was the guy because that was his focus. And then he met you. And immediately that day, his question changed to, Lord, what do you want me to do? And he spent the rest of his life asking that question and listening for the answer and then seeking to reach whatever goal you set for him that day. What a beautiful life of discipleship. What a blessing he was to so many believers back then and even to us today. 2,000 years later, we're still reading and looking at his example. Help us to search our own lives today. Are we seeking for ourselves? Are we seeking our own reward? Are we setting our own goal, our own finish line? Or are we treating everybody else like they matter more than we do today? Are we willing to set aside blessings that are due us and rightfully ours just so that we might benefit somebody else? Because that is taking up our cross and following you. Lord, help us to do that. By the power of your Holy Spirit, I pray that you would just consume us with a zeal for you. To know you rightly, to share you rightly, and to really be all in. Let us be that fellowship. Have your way in us. It's in Jesus' holy name. And all God's people said, amen. Love y'all.